Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Nursery Earth, the wondrous lives of baby animals and the extraordinary ways they shape our world, written by Danna Staaf and read by Norma Butikofer. Foreword by Richard Strathman, PhD. In the animal kingdom, adulthood gets all the attention. We think first of the proud, soaring eagle, not the chick, the green, leaping frog, not the tadpole. Birth, infancy, the march toward maturation, these are too often mistaken for nothing more than stages of a waiting game as an animal grows into its fully realized adult form. In this groundbreaking book, Danna Staaf shows us how much we've been missing. A whole wondrous world of baby animals that most of us almost entirely overlook, but that deserve, that demand our attention. Few among us, amateur nature lovers and specialists alike, have even the vaguest notion of the extraordinary, ingenious, and astonishingly diverse lives of baby animals. Staaf brings the research together for the first time in popular book form, compiling cutting-edge science with the most jaw-dropping stories of young life finding its way in the world. Her boundless enthusiasm for baby animals is infectious. In fact, Staaf reveals a tendency toward enthusiasm and obsession that prevails among those who endeavor to understand the very different ways that living things grow up. The more you know about animal babies, the more you'll realize you can hardly blame us. We developmental biologists have front-row seats to perhaps the greatest show in the natural world. In this book, you too will soon find out what truly makes the youngest life among us so irresistible. And it isn't because they're cute and cuddly. Some are, but some most certainly aren't. Rather, we're drawn to and inspired by this time of animal life that's so unlike any other. At the very moment that they're most defenseless, animal babies are also at peak sensitivity to their surroundings, and that's, in essence, their superpower. They respond and adapt to their environment with incredible ingenuity. Their strategies for survival can be practically otherworldly, and their path toward maturity can upend all expectation. In short, our fellow creatures' vulnerable beginnings make for the most fascinating and consequential time of their lives. All creatures composed of many cells, including us humans, benefit from reverting to a single cell at some point of the life cycle. Passing through this one-cell bottleneck provides benefits for sex and for purging the future generation of harmful mutations and pathogens, but it also creates a challenge: how to start as an egg and survive and grow to full multicellular capabilities in a world of risks. Animals share the challenge, in water and in air, of a one-celled beginning. From this modest, poorly equipped beginning, each developing animal needs nutrition, defense, oxygen, and waste disposal, plus, often, a way to move around. Nursery Earth is a fascinating tour of the variety of ways these needs and others are met. Of course, improving our stewardship of the planet is necessary if we want an Earth that truly serves as a nursery for all nature's young. Staaf describes the wonder at seeing a little sphere, an egg, turn into a functioning animal in the lab, and the even greater wonder at how many babies like these survive in the harsher world outside the lab. Staaf also speaks to biologists' growing concerns for the future. Some hazards, from predators, parasites, and pathogens, to desiccation and suffocation, are old, but many, such as artificial chemicals and climate change, are new. The perils can sound formidable, but in this fun and engaging account, humor outweighs the pathos, parasitic wasps a possible exception. In Nursery Earth, you'll also discover the ways we're part of the story. What we humans do to care for our babies resembles strategies that are not limited to our closer kin. Mother mammals, for example, aren't the only mothers who nourish babies internally through their blood or externally through their milk. But Staaf also shows that we don't need to depend on finding human-like similarities in other animals to love and admire them. Instead, Animals with strangely different forms and habits earn our appreciation and sympathy. There's charm in a scarab beetle, say, sequestering its baby in a protective and nourishing ball of dung. And the versatility with which some wasp embryos and starfish larvae can multiply themselves is beyond impressive. Nursery Earth makes a compelling case that it's better to think of baby animals as fully realized creatures unto themselves, not becoming something else, but being incredible living things in their own right. We all, as listeners, will find much to ponder and enjoy in animals' seemingly infinite range of journeys from birth to adult. And it's no exaggeration to say that the world depends on their creative ways to stay alive. As these tiny creatures eat and grow and migrate, they become needles and threads, stitching together diverse ecosystems and shaping the future of our world. Richard Strathman, PhD, is a leading expert in the diverse patterns of animal development, with a particular focus on marine animals. He finds the beauty and variety of changes from eggs through embryos, larvae, and metamorphosis endlessly entertaining. He has been on the faculty of the University of Washington since 1973. Introduction. A world of the babies, by the babies, for the babies. There was a child went forth every day, and the first object he looked upon, that object he became, and that object became part of him for the day, or a certain part of the day, or for many years, or stretching cycles of years. Walt Whitman, Leaves of Grass. Baby animals are undeniably cute. Puppies tumbling over each other, joeys peeking out of kangaroo pouches, ducklings paddling in a wobbly line. Baby animals are also incredibly bizarre. Moth larvae mimic both snakes and feces. Featherless finch chicks beg with beaks like Mondrian paintings. And let's not forget baby humans, with our squishy skulls and taste buds on our tonsils. Baby animals are very sensitive to the environment. Bird embryos die when their eggshells are thinned by DDT or smothered by spilled oil. Shellfish larvae can't grow into edible adults until they find the perfect home in a sea full of increasingly imperfect habitat. But baby animals are also powerful enough to change the environment, for both good and ill from the human perspective. Agricultural pests, like rootworms and borers, are actually infant insects, and they devastate crops on every continent. At the same time, numerous beetle larvae can actually digest plastic, offering hope for pollution cleanup. Even human babies embody this combination of vulnerability and voracity. When we're born, we don't know a single language, leaving us at the mercy of our adult caretakers. Yet we are so ravenous to learn that we can pick up as many languages as we are exposed to, an ability the adults around us have lost. Similarly, as babies, our incomplete immune systems put us at risk from infections that rarely affect adults. But these same baby immune systems are primed to build relationships with beneficial bacteria that will serve us the rest of our lives. If we're exposed to too many dangers or deprived of necessary resources, our sensitivity becomes a weakness. But in the right environment, it blooms into a superpower. Scientists who study early life stages by dripping chemicals on tadpoles or feeding chicks experimental diets or injecting genes into fly eggs are known as developmental biologists. Developmental biology is the study of how animals build their bodies, an examination of every process between fertilization and maturity. As a field of research, it has progressed through its own fascinating and sometimes turbulent developmental stages. In the 19th century, it was called embryology, and its practitioners peered through microscopes to watch an egg cell cleave into 2, 4, 8, and many more cells, then eventually grow a gut and a brain. The work of embryologists expanded to produce and bud off the entire field of genetics in the 20th century, and developmental biology is now expanding again to link the microscopic stages of animal growth with global environment and ecology. Unexpected connections are the forte of developmental biology. Adult onset diseases like cancer and diabetes are increasingly understood to result from influences in early life, even as early as the womb. Not only humans, but many other animals face challenges to health, longevity, and survival that trace their roots to chemical exposure or resource limitation in babyhood. And although these challenges highlight the vulnerability of youth, they also illuminate its adaptability. When a developing baby doesn't get enough nutrition, it can preferentially devote its limited energy to growing critical organs like the heart and brain, leaving more redundant organs like kidneys to suffer the brunt of starvation. This postpones problematic symptoms until later in life, giving the animal a chance to reproduce first. Thus, surviving long enough to grow up and manifest kidney disease is a triumph of the flexibility of early development. At no other stage in our lives are animals more capable of perceiving and responding to changes in the environment. In intimate conversation with our inanimate surroundings, as well as with our fellow cohabitors of Earth, we mold our bodies to match our world. Within this capacity for change lies the future of life as we know it. The diversity of developmental forms. When we think of the world's diverse animal life, we usually think of adult animals, frogs and butterflies, jellyfish and echidnas, not tadpoles and caterpillars, ephyra and puggles. Believe it or not, those baby names match the parents that precede them. Even when we turn our minds to baby animals, we tend to forget that they don't always look like their parents. This leads to the occasional amusing contradiction in children's books, like a daddy caterpillar or a baby bee. In reality, daddy caterpillars are moths or butterflies, and baby bees are wingless white larvae. What is a larva, besides the singular form of larvae? The word describes a baby that goes through a distinct metamorphosis to become an adult. Most animals have one or more larval stages. Because larvae can look so different from adults, this creates a constant puzzle for biologists, who must piece disparate forms into a single life cycle. Some species' larvae have never been seen. Other larvae are not yet associated with an adult. Larvae don't have to be tiny. Nor are all tiny babies necessarily larval forms. Bluefin tuna and kangaroos, both of which can grow to well over 3 feet, 1 meter, as adults, produce babies about an inch, 2.5 centimeters, long. The tuna hatchling is a larva. The kangaroo joey is not. Newborn kangaroos look like early embryos, but they can crawl better than newborn humans. After making their way to the pouch, they'll stay in it for about the length of a human pregnancy. On the other end of the scale are the chick of a kiwi, not a larva, and the maggot of a tsetse fly, a larva, both born nearly the same size as their parents. A mother kiwi lays the largest eggs of any bird relative to her body size. A bellyful of yolk sustains the chick until it learns to forage for food. This size variation arises because animals can't invest infinite energy in producing offspring. There's a trade-off between size and number. Kiwis lay one gigantic egg at a time, while tuna spawn millions of mini eggs. In both cases, the babies that hatch from the eggs are independent, striking out on their own. Kiwi parents allocate their reproductive effort to building mass, producing a baby large enough to have a good chance of solo survival. Tuna parents allocate theirs to quantity, producing enough babies that it doesn't matter if only a few survive. Kangaroos follow a third route, pouring their resources into parental care. Although each baby is minuscule, it receives the warm protection of a pouch and a constant infusion of milk for up to a year after birth. Thus, although a newborn kangaroo is as tiny as a newborn tuna, an independent kangaroo is far closer in size to an adult. Whether a baby turns to its parents or to the wild world to supply its needs, it is exquisitely well-equipped to do so. Kangaroo joeys have tough arms for climbing from the birth canal to the pouch. Larval tuna have, relatively, enormous jaws for swallowing prey nearly as big as they are. Larval parasites may be some of the most specialized babies of all, built to create links between disparate forms of life. As the tiny seeds of mighty trees are adapted to find a new home by hooking onto an animal carrier or hitching a ride on the wind, so baby tapeworms help themselves travel to a new host. A tiny worm seed can infect a human through the consumption of undercooked pork, as cleverly described by the embryologist poet Walter Garstang.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.